want to turn in your Bibles to John this morning. We're going to be back in the Gospel of John where we left off when we were going through it originally back in chapter 14. We kind of did a few side steps here and there to have the triumphal entry, Good Friday, and Resurrection Sunday. So we're going to circle back this morning to chapter 14. Now, before we get started in John chapter 14, there's one verse or one passage I would like to look at real quickly in Luke chapter 11, because I'm going to reference the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit, because of some of the teachings of the church, has become or could be confusing. And I like to keep it strictly to what the Bible says, and that way we're not into our own procedures or traditions. So when I talk about the Holy Spirit, the Lord wants us to live a holy and godly life. And he empowers us to do that. And the Holy Spirit indwelling inside of us is the power and the strength to do that. So a lot of times people will ask, well, how do I know that I'm filled with the Holy Spirit, or how to become filled with the Holy Spirit? And if you look in Luke chapter 11, chapter 9 through 13, it says, "And I say unto you, ask and it shall be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and it will be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh, receiveth, and he that seeketh, findeth, and to him that knocketh, it shall be opened. If a son shall ask bread of any of you that is a father, will he give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will you give him a serpent? Or if he shall ask an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them who ask?" So if you want to know about the Holy Spirit or how to receive the Holy Spirit, be as simple as a child. Jesus said that the kingdom of heaven is like a child, that we accept Christ that way. We say, yes, I've sinned. Yes, I need a Savior. And we accept Jesus as our Savior. We turn from our life of sin and we turn to him. No different when it comes to the Holy Spirit. You say, God, I want to live a godly life and I want to be empowered to serve you. Then you ask him to receive the Holy Spirit. And he simply gives it to you. So as we look at chapter 13 and 14, in chapter 13 was when Jesus was in the upper room, and they were kind of jockeying for position, deciding who was going to be the greatest in the kingdom of God. And so Jesus washed their feet and showed them what the kingdom of God was about, that the kingdom of God is about service, that those who'd be great should be the least, and that as Christians we are to be servants first and foremost. And then he says, later in the chapter, in chapter 13, he says that there's going to be someone who's a betrayer among them. Then he says to Peter that he's going to deny him. So we have them not being servants, we have them being betrayers and being deniers. But he says in chapter 14, as we opened up a few weeks ago, it says, "But don't let your hearts be troubled." The Lord, when he called you and he asked you to be his servant, he factored in all the screw-ups. He factored in every time you're going to fail. He's not expecting perfection out of you. He's expecting you to be you. I love the passage in Psalm where David says, "You know my heart, you know my frame, and I'm just dust." That's all we are. God made us out of the dust. That's all we are. So he knows how you are, and he deals with you the way that you are. He doesn't hold it against you. Later on in John, we had already read this, but when Jesus resurrected, he appeared to the guys who were hiding. He says, "Just as God sent me, I'm sending you." And like I said before, had it been you or I, we would have said, "You guys haven't proven anything yet. You need some more schooling. You know, you guys messed up tremendously." But God didn't look at it that way. He said, "As the Lord has sent me, I'm sending you." So So the calling doesn't change, and he still has an opportunity for every one of us, wherever we're at, to do exactly what he wants us to do. So he says, don't let your heart be troubled. Then he talks to them about heaven. He says, I go to prepare a place for you. So he gives them that heavenly perspective. Then he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. So he makes the salvation message very simple. They said, well, show us the Father. And he said, when you've seen me, you've seen the Father. If you're in me, the Father is in you, and I am in you, and you are in us. So he really makes it so simple for them. That's why he says, don't let your hearts be troubled. Because when we think of Christianity and the daunting path before us, that is the failures in our life or the trials in our life or not knowing what direction we should go, God has factored that in. He knows about that. So he makes it very simple to these disciples. As we go through this passage, I want you to know there's a lot covered here. So if you're listening and all of a sudden your mind drifts off in something that I'm talking about, good for you. There's a lot to digest here. If you're like one of these people that has to get it all, then listen to it online. But it's okay to drift off in a certain direction here because there are some really deep direction that this is going. Christianity is about other people. It's about the kingdom of God, and it's about eternity. And that is counter. That's very simple, isn't it? It's about other people. It's about eternity, and it's about the kingdom of God. So it's a very simple thing to talk about. But the complex part about it is if you check in with a three-year-old, I think, is the best barometer of human nature. Because you know what a three-year-old knows about other people? Zero. Their world revolves around them. What else does it revolve around? Now. Here and now and me. Here, now, me. That's all a three-year-old knows. And you can't fault a three-year-old for being a three-year-old. That's what they are. So we sit there, we talk to them, and we work with them, knowing that inside of them is somewhere deep down, some people deeper than others, but deep down, the idea that we can get across that there's other people in the world. And patience, we can wait for things. But even like when they get to be 6 or 7, have you ever taught a kid where somewhere else was? Like you look on the globe, we're going on vacation, here's where we live, here's North Carolina. Well, it's only that far away. How long can it take you to get that far? So the idea of somewhere else, and the idea of some other time, and the idea of other people is hardwired against us. We are instinctually creatures of here and now and me. Our whole society and marketing is based on it, isn't it? You know, materialism. When do we want it? Now. We'll make some payments for, I was hearing about ATVs and boats. Now they're selling them and have 20-year mortgages on them. That's real. It's only $200 a month. Why? So I can have that thing now in here for me. So three-year-olds, I should say there's a three-year-old inside of each one of us. The here, now, me thing. That's in our human nature. But the Lord is telling these people, telling his disciples, there's a place called heaven, and there's a person, it's me. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. So there's really only one issue in the whole wide world, dwelling in Jesus, abiding in Christ, staying in him. And that would be like, okay, well, I want to do that. Well, how do you do that practically? And that's what Jesus is trying to tell us. He's trying to tell us practically how we do that. He says that if we obey my commands, then you can be in me. And then he says, I'm going to send someone like me, the Holy Spirit, another comforter, to help you do this. Because we could not do this on our own. All of your efforts equal zero. We're going to read that in the chapter. It says, apart from me, you can do nothing. I would say very little, right? Not a lot. I get some done. Nope. And what's funny is you can actually get stuff done apart from God, can't you? Apart from God, you can do it, but it won't represent God, will it? It won't do anything for the kingdom of God. It won't be doing anything for anyone else. That's why at this church, I'm a big fan. People can serve if they want to. But if you don't want to serve, you don't want to do something, don't. God doesn't need your, like, oh, character. Oh, I'm just going to grunt this one out. Do it out of the overflow of your heart or don't do it at all. Give whatever you give completely out of the overflow of your heart. Don't do it out of compulsion, because you're not going to make yourself better in front of God's eyes. I'm always joking about the stars on your charts, you know, like, oh, I couldn't make it to Wednesday night because I was like, oh, well, we'll still put a star on your chart. Thanks for the excuse. You know, rest easy. You know, I know your heart was in it, so we'll give you a star. God isn't on the star system. He's on the blood system. If you're under the blood of Christ, you're perfect in his eyes. And if you're not, you need to be. Period. So he's trying to get his disciples to understand this concept. And this concept is huge. It's gigantic. But it's simple. But again, it goes against everything that we're wired. So let's look, and we'll pick up reading in verse 15 of chapter 14. He's talked about that he is the way, that he is the, if you've seen the Father, you've seen him, and he's talked about going to prepare a place for them. Now in verse 15 it says, if you love me, obey my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate, another comforter, who will never leave you. He is the Holy Spirit who leads into all truth. The world cannot receive him because it isn't looking for him and doesn't recognize him. But you know him because he lives with you, and later he will be in you. Now that's a key verse. He lives with you, later he will be in you. It says, no, I will not abandon you as orphans. I will come to you. Soon the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Since I live, you also will live. When I am raised again, you will know that I am in the Father, and that you are in me, and that I am in you. Those who accept my commandments and obey them are the ones who love me. And because they love me, my Father will love them, and I will love them, and reveal myself to each of them. Do you see how you're in Christ? Christ is in the Father. The Father is in Christ. That we are all together in that. If you are in Christ, you are accepted by God completely. Because God doesn't see your failures and flaws. Like, let's just say, theoretically, I ate some of that bakery before I came up here. Theoretically. You don't know that, do you? Because it's in me. It's covered by me. So when you try to look at that bakery, you see me. And that's how we are in Christ. We're in Christ. God doesn't see our sin, God sees Jesus. We are perfect in his eyes if we're in the Son. So the thing is, are you in the Son? So he's going to keep pushing that over and over again. Every time he talks about obedience, he immediately follows it up with the Holy Spirit. Because you have no ability to obey without the Holy Spirit. You have no ability to abide in Christ without the Holy Spirit's power. Otherwise, if you did, and some of you might be recoiling at that, you might be like, well, I am. Well, I guarantee it is making you self-righteous. If you do it under your own power, you got something to brag about, don't you? And then if you don't measure up to that, then you're self-condemning. So either self-righteous or self-condemning. Either one is kind of a blight on Christianity. What we need to be is Christ-centered. So if someone says, you're doing a great job, you go, glory to God. Someone says, you don't even act like a Christian. Like, well, praise God for Jesus. When the devil comes to you and accuses you, you don't act like a Christian. You shouldn't call yourself a Christian. You're not like other Christians. You should say, you're absolutely right. And that's why Jesus died on the cross. you keep putting the cross right up there. Because that's the only thing you have. That is the antidote to self-loathing or self-righteousness. You see, Jesus did it all. Everything. Now he says that the Holy Spirit is with you, and then it's going to be in you. And what that means is that to come to Christ, nobody just wakes up some morning and goes, I need Jesus. I need to be reconciled by the Father. Because it says there are none doeth, there is none that seeketh me. There's none that doeth good. There's none that, I'm butchering this. Let's just put it this way. Nobody is preset for doing good. If you feel the need for Jesus, it's because the Holy Spirit is prompting your heart that you need Jesus. The Holy Spirit does that convicting work. He speaks of righteousness, sin, and judgment to come. That's the Holy Spirit's job. Did you know that? He tells you what's right, he tells you what's wrong, and he tells you there's a judgment coming. So, I won't ask for you to raise hands. How many of you tried to play that role for the Holy Spirit? That's a dangerous game when you get inside and say, I got this one, God. I'll convict this person of righteousness, you know, unrighteousness and judgment to come. We need to present the word of God to people, present the plan of God to people, but trust that God's going to do that heart work inside of them. But the Holy Spirit is with you. That's convicting you. When you accept Christ as your Savior, he is in you. He seals you for all eternity. Puts a seal on you. That's mine. He does that salvation work. He regenerates your heart. He regenerates your being. He makes you spiritually alive. But later on in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, he's going to say, but you will receive power after that the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you'll be witnesses to me both in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. That upon experience is when he is literally doing it all. He's in me. Good days and bad days. When I'm having a bad day, you know what the Holy Spirit's doing? He's in me going, Rich, 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 Rich. Stop it, Rich, stop it, Rich, Rich. You know, he's convicting me from the inside out. But when he's upon me is when you go, that's not Rich, that's somebody else. It is a good thing. That's what we're looking for from Christianity, is that we're overflowing. We're not doing it out of a deficit. We're doing it out of an overflow of our heart. That's the Holy Spirit upon. How do you receive that upon? Can I have a piece of bread? Can I have an egg? I'm hungry, Mom. I'm hungry, Dad. Can you please feed me? And a good parent's going to be like, well, sure. Now, here's a rock. It says, if you being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more the Father's going to give you? So you might ask for a Mercedes, and you might say, that's not what you need. So he doesn't give you everything you ask for. Don't get me wrong. He gives you what you need when you're in need. So you might think that you need something else, and you ask for something, and you get something else, but it's not a rock. It's not a scorpion. It's not a snake. It's not something bad. Don't be afraid to open yourself up and say, God, whatever you got for me, because I'm in need. I can't do it without you. Would you please supply the need? And God is happy, more than happy to do that for you. If it's not about you and now and here, if it's about other people, and it's about the kingdom, and it's about eternity, more than happy to oblige. Jesus replied in verse 23, wait a second, 22. He's talking about, in this text, he's saying, I'm in the Father is in me, I am in you. The ones you love, and you love me, and the Father loves them. And all of a sudden, Judas, who's not Judas Iscariot, a different disciple named Judas, in verse 22 says, Lord, why are you going to reveal yourself only to us and not to the world at large? Now, this is a great question. It's like, well, okay, I know that about us here, but what about them out there? Why do you think he asked that question? He says, I know, that's good. Okay, now I know how to live my Christian life. Now I know how to be right with God. I'm going to be Holy Spirit empowered. I'm going to live for the kingdom. I'm going to live for eternity. I'm not going to be about myself. What about those guys? He's not going to do that to the world. The world is not going to conform itself to Jesus Christ. And you're not going to get it done either. I want to ask you something. How many times did God, in his word, affect his will by an election? By a law being passed? By that human effort to try to change the world into his image? How politically active was Christ and his disciples? While he was alive and then after his death? Simple question. How well does that work when we try to do it? There's only one way to change a society. There's only one way to change a person. From the inside out. There's only one cure we have. It's Jesus Christ. That's the way we have to win the world. Because he says, what about the world? You know? Lord, why are you going to reveal yourself only to us and not to the world at large? Jesus replied, all who love me will do what I say. Isn't that funny? He doesn't answer his question, does he? He said, all that love me will do what I say. My Father will love them, and we will come and make our home in each of them. This is a perfect picture of the Trinity. Did you know that? All who love me will do what I say, and my Father will love them, and we, the Father and the Son, will come and make my home with each one of them. That's the Holy Spirit. Anyone who doesn't love me will not obey me. And remember, my words are not my own. What I'm telling you is from the Father who sent me. I'm telling you these things now while I'm still with you. But when the Father sends the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, as my representative, that is the Holy Spirit, he will teach you everything. It will remind you of everything I've told you. See, he gets that they're not going to get all this that he's talking to them about. And later on, when these disciples were writing books, they're like, and we didn't realize, we remembered later what he had said. So today, if you're not getting all this, that's fine. The Holy Spirit will bring it into remembrance. That's the power of the Word of God when you share it with somebody. That later on, God will bring that to the surface. The Holy Spirit will bring his Word to fruition. The Word of God does not come back void. Just put it on somebody. Just, here you go. That's what the Bible says. Well, I don't like that. Well, I didn't say it. That's what the Bible says. And then later on, God will use the Bible. It says, this is the Spirit. He will teach you everything and will remind you of everything I've told you. I'm leaving you with a gift, peace of mind and heart. And the peace I give is a gift that the world cannot give. So don't be troubled or afraid. Isn't that something? What's he giving us? What's the gift that God has given each one of us? Peace. Peace of mind. Do you have peace of mind this morning? You cool with the way the world's going? They're two different things, aren't they? I'm not cool with the way the world's going, but it doesn't rattle me. I still have peace of mind because they're going to do what they're going to do. And my job's different than that. I got a different kingdom. It's not about me. It's not about here. It's about other people. It's about the kingdom of God. So don't be troubled or afraid. Remember what I told you. I'm going away, but I will come back to you again. If you really loved me, you would be happy that I'm going to the Father, who is greater than I am. I've told you these things before they happen, so that when they do happen, you will believe. I don't have much more time to talk to you, because the ruler of this world approaches. He has no power over me, but I will do what the Father requires of me, so that the world will know that I love the Father. Come, let's be going. Now, he tells them these lessons, and then he takes off, and he's going to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray and sweat drops of blood. And on the way there is the temple. And on the side of that temple was a giant vine, like a vineyard, like a thing of a vineyard. Vines and grapes and branches. And he sees it and he stops and he gives them this object lesson of the vine and the branches. And it's no different than what we just read. It's the same lesson. It's just in a picture so you can see it. He says, I am the true grapevine, and my father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch of mine that doesn't produce fruit, and he prunes the branches that do bear fruit so they will produce even more. You've already been pruned and purified by the message I've given you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. For a branch cannot produce fruit unless it is severed from the vine, and you cannot be fruitful unless you remain in me. Yes, I am the vine, and you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in them will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. Anyone who does not remain in me is thrown away like a useless branch and withers. Such branches are gathered into a pile and burned. But if you remain in me and my words remain in you, you may ask for anything you want, and it will be granted. When you produce much fruit, you are my true disciples. This brings great glory to the Father. So he sees this picture, and he goes, this is what I'm talking about. Because he says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. He says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And he says, obey me, and then you will produce fruit. You will obey my commandments. So obeying his commandments means being in him, means in the Father. What comes out of that? Fruit. What is fruit? Because if I say, you guys need to be producing fruit. What is fruit? You know, because that's one of those Christian things, you know. What's the fruit of your life? People go, I don't know. I'm not a pastor, so what does that look like? If you look in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, 23, it says, the fruit of the Spirit is love. Love is the big word. And then that love is described by all the words underneath it. Joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, kindness, meekness, self-control. So that's what's supposed to be coming out of our lives. You say, well, that sounds a little too simple. Someone could just get off really easy that way, couldn't they? Yep. Just go around with love. Did you know you can fulfill the whole law and the prophets by just loving your neighbor as yourself and loving the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength? Simple stuff, isn't it?
I'm sorry, I was messing with these
hearing aids. That's all right. You have just lost the star off your chart. I think, okay, he gets... Okay, you got a star back for me insulting you. No, God knew that was going to happen. No, the idea of being a good person and fulfilling the law and doing what you're supposed to be doing is simple, abiding in Christ, loving God and loving others. You're like, well, that's easy. I'll just do that. I would almost say to you, well, good luck with that. Tell me how that goes. Love God and love others. That's impossible, Rich. Without the Holy Spirit's indwelling, it is. So when you're not able to love God and love others, what do? You say, I'm sorry. Lord, I wasn't abiding in you. I did that. That was on me, God. That wasn't me listening to you. That was me just acting normally. When that guy pulled out in front of me, shouldn't have done that. I'm sorry. Then when someone comes to you and says, oh, you know, Christians, you're so righteous. You're like, no, we're not. I've never met once. I mean, think about the holiest people you've ever met in your life. Ask them if they think they're holy. They say, no, I'm the chiefest of sinners. I'm thinking of one particular lady. She was like practically a saint. At her funeral, it's like, wow, this lady is everyone. When I talked to her, I asked her about it, something one day, and she said, oh, I struggle all the time. Nobody escapes the struggle. whether it be, you know, you look back at these greats of the Spurgeon and John Calvin and all these great preachers of all time, Billy Graham. What did they say? They all struggled with sin. Sin, the struggle with sin, should make us be completely humble and gracious. When you find yourself in that spot where you struggle with sin after your own flesh, that it makes you self-righteous and judgmental, that's a bad thing. That's a tough road to be on. Because you stand before God then saying, judge me according to my righteousness. And I'm going to take a step back. I don't want to be judged on my righteousness. I want to be a judge in Jesus. I don't want to be a judgmental Christian. I want to be a loving Christian. Someone who has peace of mind, gentleness, self-control. I want to be marked by those characteristics. And this Christian walk, it can seem like it's complicated, but it's not that complicated. It's like, I want to abide in you. And you abide in me. And then I can represent you properly to the people around me, to the world that needs to see you. Now, some of these passages, this passage itself has been used to kind of scare people, like, okay, well, if you want to produce fruit, God's going to cut you and burn you, take branches off of you. Here comes the Holy Spirit pruning. You know, I've had things cut off of me, out of my life. It's called deliverance. I'm no longer a slave to sin. The things that I enjoy and that I love in life, I don't have to worry about God taking those away. But the idea of, some people think that you can lose your salvation based on this, like, if you don't abide, God's going to cut your branch off and burn you. How do you like that? The end. So you all better behave. But that's a serious thing. So I'll address it. I don't think I should just flippantly bypass it. I'll just say this. If you are staying saved by your works, then you are being saved by your works. And you can't be saved by your works, can you? Your works have nothing to do with your salvation. So where do works come in? And where does this abiding come in? Where's this flame, like fire? It says, gather it up and burn. So, in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 10, there's a judgment in the Bible called the Bema Seat Judgment. There's the Great White Throne Judgment. That's where people go to be judged, to go to hell for all eternity for rejecting Christ. But there's another judgment where God judges people, Christians, according to their works. Did you know that? Some people go, well, I'm just saved. I don't really care. I don't care about trophies or honors. And I'm like, I do. I want to finish first. I want them all. If there's a trophy in heaven, I want to get it. I want to live my life so that I can stand before God. And like, I want to get everything he has for me. Now, somebody might say, well, you might do works then out of ambition. And therefore, they'd be burned up because you just did it because you wanted a reward. Like, yep, maybe so. But I'm going to keep working at it. I'm going to keep doing that. You know, it's like, and God says, don't labor for the things that can be burned with fire. Labor for the things, store up treasures in heaven. Do I get to store up treasures in heaven? Do I get to try to do that? Paul says, strive that you might obtain the prize. Do I get to strive to maintain so I can get a prize in heaven? If God's giving out prizes, I want one of them bad boys. I don't know what it is, but I want it. When I see what God makes, the good things God makes, I want two. If there's three crowns in heaven, I want three. If there's four, I want four. I want whatever God has for me, 100%. And I have found that in striving for that in this earth, that brings me joy and peace. That gives me an abundant life. So I get a two-for-one special. I get a better in this life and then a prize in things to come. And if you're worried, like, maybe the stuff you're doing might get burned up because you have the wrong motives, I just say pile a bunch of stuff on there. If half of it gets burned up, at least you got half. I'm serious. Like, there's a guy, we used to play basketball, and he used to shoot the ball all the time. Like, why do you shoot out all the ball all the time? He's like, because I've missed every shot I've never taken. Michael Jordan said, I failed, therefore I succeed. He listed all of his stats of all of the games he ever lost with a game-winning shot. They put the ball in his hand and he missed. He said, but I was able to win because I was willing to lose. If you're not able to win because you're willing to lose, it's the same thing as when God gives these people talents and one of them buries it in the ground and says, here's your talent back. I didn't risk anything. Just take it. He said, you're a wicked servant. Don't be a wicked servant. Take what God's given you. Risk it all. Lose it all. But try. I'm not saying do things wrong. I'm saying just do the right thing. In verse 10 of chapter 3, it says, because of God's grace to me, I've laid the foundation like an expert. This is Paul talking to the Corinthian church. And the foundation is Jesus Christ, none but Christ. Now others are building on it. But whoever is building on this foundation must be very careful, for no one can lay any foundation other than the one we already have, Jesus Christ. That's the foundation. That's my bedrock. That's the only thing I lean on. So if I'm going to work, I'm going to work from that. Anyone who builds on the foundation may use a variety of materials. Gold, silver, jewels, wood, hay, or straw. But on judgment day, fire will reveal what kind of work each builder has done. The fire will show if a person's work is of any value. So the fire will show if the work has any value. If the work survives, the builder will receive a reward. But if the work is burned up, the builder will suffer great loss. The builder will be saved, but like someone escaping through a wall of flames. Here we have a guy, did his works. His works are on the scale. His works are in the pile. And God looks at him because his eyes are consuming fire. He looks at what you've done and what isn't right gets burned up. He looks on your little pile there or your big pile or whatever it is and woof, it all goes away. This would be the symbolistic of a Christian who didn't do anything for God that was worthwhile. But they're still saved. So if you walk up to someone in heaven, they got no rewards, but they smell like smoke. That's what it says. They will escape, but though it's through a wall of fire, so they like smell like smoke. But they're still in heaven. His soul will be saved. Why? Because you're building on the foundation. The foundation is Christ. You can't burn that up. You're in him. You build from there. You build wrong. It doesn't work. It doesn't count for anything. Like you can throw up anything in about a day. You know, just get some wood. Framing looks good. Put it on the fire. So you build with precious stones, metal, things that don't burn up in the fire, things that last forever. Those are harder and they're more expensive, but they last. What's harder and more expensive in life than investing in others, than investing in the future, than investing in the kingdom of God? How did that investment pay off for Jesus or the disciples in their lifetime? They had their times. You know, they had times that were really cool. They saw miracles. There were things. It's not like their life was a drag. They actually had a really good time in life. But when Jesus died on the cross, one disciple was there. All the others had fled. When they were waiting at Pentecost, you know how many people were there? 120. So was Jesus' ministry a great, wonderful, dynamic, growing ministry? No, he was a failure by the world standards. The apostle Paul was beheaded. The other disciples ran through with spears, torn apart. Discipleship and following God is not the way to get ahead in this world. It's a way to get ahead eternally. It's a way to reach others. If you consume it upon yourself, then it will be wood, hay, and stubble. It'll get burnt up. And that's, how do we decide this? Like I said, that's between you and God. God is the one who judges. If you stay in Christ and you stay full of his Spirit, you'll be good. So how does that look practically? Because I like practical stuff. You know, like you talk this, like, boy, there's a lot of stuff going on here. Like I said, I don't mind if your mind goes off in one direction today. Because I'm throwing a lot of stuff out there. But one of my favorite pastors ever, and he is a very sincere guy. He's a little bit, I don't know, maybe too common for some folk. But he said, it's simple. He said, wake up every morning, ask the Lord to fill you with his Holy Spirit. Say, Lord, fill me with your Holy Spirit. I'm going to give the day to you. He said, then ask God to give you the sensitivity that when you quench that, that you'll feel it. He said, the amount of days that you put in a row like that, he said, try to pray it sincerely, because by the second or third day, it'll just become something you say. So as sincerely as you can, pray that every day. If you do that, I guarantee you, your life will be in Christ. You will experience joy. You will experience peace. If you go, I got this one. However many days you put in a row where you go, I don't need that, I got this one. Or you just don't think about it. Just get up, roll out of bed, and just live your day like you normally do. What's that look like? Frustration, anger, worry. Not love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, kindness. It's really, like I said, it's simple, but it's counterintuitive. It's simple, but it doesn't go with our natures. So he says, I have loved you even as the Father has loved me. Remain in my love. Verse 10. When you obey my commandments, you remain in my love. Just as I obey my Father's commandment and remain in his love. I've told you these things so that you will be filled with my joy. Yes, your joy will overflow. Why is he telling them this? Because he wants their joy to be overflowing. Do you have overflowing joy? If you don't, just do what it says. This is my commandment. Love each other in the same way I've loved you. There is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you slaves because a master doesn't confide in his slaves. Now you are my friends. Since I've told you everything the Father told me, you didn't choose me, I chose you. I appointed you to go and produce lasting fruit, so the Father will give you whatever you ask using my name. This is my command, love each other. Nobody in the Old Testament looked up to heaven and went, Father. Did you know that? They didn't look at themselves that way. They looked at themselves as creation, creators. It was God himself, Jesus said, Father, they went blasphemer. So when I say Father, back then they would have called me blasphemer. But I'd say, no, I'm in Christ, and he told me that that's my Father. I say, Abba, Father. You know what else you didn't say to God? Friend. Are you a friend of God? He says we are. We're his friends. That is really amazing. God's my friend. Doesn't that sound way too casual and not near righteous enough? Not near, I'm afraid to say that. I said, God's my buddy. God's my friend. God's my pal. That sounds way too familiar, doesn't it? And I wouldn't be able to say that if it weren't for Jesus saying it. Because in my own mind and heart, I'm like, now I'm more like Father, like God in heaven, you know. Different people pray different ways. Some people say, hey, God. I love it when people pray like that. I can't do that. I'm like, oh, that's way too casual for me. But I like it. I think it's better. But I have this more of like this. So when he says I can call him his friend and that he can be my father, like daddy, that's a great privilege that we all have. It says, if the world, and then he goes back to the world here again. Because this is all about you. This is how we're supposed to behave in here. He goes back to the world again. He goes, if the world hates you, remember that it hated me first. The world will love you as it loves its own, if you belong to it. But you are no longer part of the world. I chose you to come out of the world, so it hates you. So it's kind of funny, you know, Mike said something about, you know, the government not honoring the Bible, like putting your hand on the Bible. They're starting to hate Christians, aren't they? Look at that. Prophecy come true. They hated Jesus. They're going to hate you. We had a little lull here in America for a while. That lull's over. We're getting back to the Bible right here. Do you remember what I told you? A slave is not greater than the master. Since they persecuted me, naturally they will persecute you. And if they listened to me, they would listen to you. They will do all this because of me, for they have rejected the one who sent me. They would not be guilty if I had not come and spoken to them. But now they have no excuse in their sin. Anyone who hates me also hates the Father. If I hadn't done such miraculous signs among them that no one else could do, they would not be guilty. But as it is, they have seen everything I did, yet they hate me and my Father. This fulfills what is written in the Scriptures. They hated me without cause. So he's saying, they hated me, even though they saw every... Why did they hate Jesus? Because he fed 5,000 people? Because he healed people? He raised people from the dead? Because he taught, love your neighbor as yourself? What reason did they crucify him? Because he said, there's only one way. And I'm it. That's why they'll hate you, because you're saying, there's only one way, and it's Jesus Christ. They hate that. They hate it, hate it, hate it. Why? Because it's exclusive. But people say, that's pretty harsh. You think you Christians have the only way? I'm like, no, I don't. I think it's very inclusive. It says anybody that believes this, doesn't matter your race, creed, color, gender, you can believe this and be saved. And if there were one cure for cancer, if there was one red pill that was a cure for cancer, nobody argued that there should be a blue pill too, or a green one, or a purple one. They just accept it. So with Jesus, they want to get, oh, that's too exclusive. No, Jesus died on the cross for everybody, of all cultures, across all ages. But they hated me without cause, and that's why they'll hate you too. But then he ends, but I will send you the advocate, the comforter, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth. He will come to you from the Father, will testify about me. And you must also testify about me because you have been with me from the beginning of my ministry. So again, with the vine, you can have a saved soul and a wasted life. Did you know that? You can be on your way to heaven and have a blasted existence because you're going directly against the will of God. If you go against the will of God, he will not sit back passively and go, oh, well, just like you wouldn't do that with one of your children. Oh, well, you're going to hurt yourself. That's okay. What would you do? Intervene in the best way you could to teach them the lessons that you want them to learn so they don't hurt themselves. So God's the same way. You can have a saved soul and a wasted life. You can be on your way to heaven and have a blasted existence. I know many Christians who suffer under a tough load because they keep making decisions that are against the kingdom of God. They keep making here, now, and me decisions. When you do that, not only do you have the consequences of that, but God's going, stop it. There's a better way. If you turn around now, we can still salvage all this. He's not like, you're out of the club. He's like, come on. Stop hurting yourself. It doesn't have to be this way. It doesn't have to be so hard. So if you're trying to follow the Lord, be in Christ, simple as waking up in the morning, give him the day. Ask for the Holy Spirit. As many days as you put in a row like that, successful Christian life. As many days as you say, forget it, I'll do what I need to do, whatever I need to, well, you'll get the results that I think we all have seen. Let's close in prayer. Lord, thank you for the practicality of your word, and I know I've thrown a lot of things out there today. I pray that anything that was misguided or misunderstood, Lord, would just fall on deaf ears. Your word is true. Your word is eternal. I pray that we would stay in your word. We would stay in obedience to you so that we would be in Christ, exalting the Father, full of peace and joy, Lord, affecting the world around us. It was your plan from the beginning, and you made it simple for people like us. But it does go against our nature, so I pray that we would surrender our nature to you and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Thanks again for bringing us together. What a joy and pleasure it is to be in the house of God. I pray that as we worship you, that we would turn our hearts to you. In Jesus' name, amen.